hybrid way, head into the tundra. And I'm not saying immediately that the practices that we were getting ready to do are not, you know, the traditional. I mean, they go to the similar place or the same place that many of the traditional practices do when you're doing daily meditation. But the pathway is slightly different because of the shortness of time that we have to explore this second vehicle of transformation, which is part of the Siddhic path. And as we said, we were going to be exploring the journey to understand the shamanic path a bit. So now we're going to be studying daily meditation to understand the Siddhic path a bit better, and to remember that both vehicles are methods of helping the practitioner move beyond the ordinary experience of life and move into the non-ordinary aspect of experience. And again, you will remember that with the shamanic thrust in doing this process is to understand the forces of nature better and to be able to work with them in a practical, focused way in human affairs. But the siddha, I mean, as Bob was saying yesterday, there are some siddhas that also work in that way, but the primary thrust of the siddhic path is self-understanding, self-transformation, the attainment of enlightenment, the understanding about the nature of reality, beyond necessarily the physical forms of nature and the non-ordinary aspect of its power. So we're heading in, you know, to an experiential process of the Siddhic path, which is a parallel or, you know, a counterpoint to the journey. That's what we're getting ready to do. Now, in order to, I have to say immediately, daily meditation is a fairly advanced practice that comes at, you know, really begin to move into this kind of tantric work until you have done quite a bit of, on a traditional Buddhist path, a lot of devotional work and, you know, a lot of study of sutra and spent a lot of time in what they call the generation stage you know, generating the capacity to be able to enter into the field of the daily. But I have a few shortcuts that are not meant to be disrespectful to the traditional path in any way, but I find work very well to give the initiate a way in to this very big and powerful way of working. And so, but we do have a few steps that we do need to take before we get there. And what I'd like to do is to do a meditation, a simple shamatha meditation. Well, it's not so simple for most of us, but compared to the deity meditation, it's more simple. I'd like to do a meditation of quieting the breath, quieting the mind through the focus on the breath. And I'm going to talk you in and then talk you out. Then we're going to do one more meditation to kind of help step in. And then we'll do the deity meditation. The first of the deity meditations. Okay? Anyone have any questions? So you can be sitting up or lying down for this, up to you. So just allowing yourself to get settled. Noticing all the places where the surface under you meets the different parts of your body. And as you do, just noticing where your breath is. Noticing as you breathe in where your breath goes. And noticing as you breathe out where your breath goes. And if any thought should come into your mind as you're breathing, watching your breath, let it pass through your mind like a cloud passing through the sky. Don't need to engage it or to fight it. Just let it pass through and then return to your breath. Watching it move in and watching it move out. I won't be doing any talking for a little while. Just continue to watch your breath. Remember, the past is gone forever. The future is not yet here. All you have is the present moment and your breath.
just allow yourself to consider breathing through your nose if you're breathing through your mouth. And if you're breathing through your mouth, you can breathe through your nose. Just feeling again the surface under you. And noticing once again every place where it meets the different parts of your body. And then just allowing yourself to stretch a bit. And when you're ready, just coming back fully into the room, taking all the time that you need. And when you're ready, just opening your eyes and just taking a moment to reflect on your experience. We won't have any talking during this time. Journal, you can write down any reflections. And if anyone has any questions about that practice, go ahead and ask me if you have something you'd like to, some comment or question you might have.
What was the you know, obviously there wasn't really an intended outcome, but you led into it with something about deities.
Oh, I said this is a preliminary practice to the, before we head into the deity. So what we're doing is, and maybe I should have been more clear, stabilizing our attention in the breath so that you can, when we get into the field of the deity, we'll be able to stabilize better.
Yeah.
So the idea with shamatha meditation is to be able to develop one pointed focus. And it's a way of training the mind, because most of us have our mind is going and we don't know where we are or what our experience is because we're being driven by the mind. What we want to be able to do is to be able to get focus and be able to then direct the mind in the way that we wish to, rather than being blown about by experience that we are not necessarily choosing to be blown about by in terms of our mind's thoughts.
So you're talking about literally like eliminating mental noise.
Exactly. And that this process of eliminating mental noise, it could be a lifetime's practice.
Yeah, I was going to say that I've never experienced a moment of silence.
Right.
But very good. Very. I suffered from panic attacks for years, multiple times a day, and then without medication, just stopped having because I got very adept at relaxing my body instead of having to take like Advan or Valium, which would relax my body for me so my mind could let go. I got very good at breathing from my diaphragm laying down and just feeling my body fall asleep. And in doing that, I was able to bring all the light I needed.
That's great. I mean, you found your way to the path. I mean, that's a valid way, you know.
But it's never quiet.
Well, I mean, you're partway there. I mean, like, considering how noisy it was, it's very quiet.
It's always noisy. It's just more humorous.
Yeah.
It'll immediately be humor. I almost laughed in the middle of that. I almost busted out laughing because there's something funny that occurs to me all the time. It just sneaks in there. And I can't, you know, it's like, how do you let go of that, which is just holding on?
Well, that's the path, right? That's and again, you know, this can be a complex process. And, you know, one thing that I would recommend that you do on a daily basis is to do at least 5 minutes of this meditation every day, and if you can, do it twice a day, so you can try to get to the place where you can get your mind to rest. I mean, you've done a great job delivering yourself from the grips of panic, but there's further to go. And you want to be able to, I mean, I imagine, it sounds like what you've done is you use your mind to do that, and now what you need to do is to be able to let go of the mind. Which is scary, because that's the thing that helped you, right?
I'm not scared of that.
All right.
I don't think, I'm not able to consciously let go of anything. It's like I have to stop trying to hold on.
Okay, so then you know the path.
I've just never heard it be quiet at all.
Yeah.
It's always noisy.
Okay. Well, for some people, letting go of that noise can be a little scary. So if you do ever get scared, don't worry. Just keep going back to your breath. and I'm not saying you will be scared, but sometimes people grip a little bit. You know that. So you want to keep letting go. Any other thoughts or comments about that meditation? Okay. So again, the shamatha process is something that you could do forever, and there's some schools of Buddhism that this is the only form of meditation that there is. And it's very powerful in and of itself. I can't recommend a daily practice of this highly enough. But we are going to move right along and pretend we've done 10 years of this and go on to the next level. And we're going to do another meditation, a combination of guided meditation and shamanic journey. So I'm going to, this is a real crossover, this is a real hybrid of shamanic practice, combining it with tantric practice, okay? And ultimately, in my opinion, tantra and shamanic practice have a very definite meeting place. So for me, it's not contradictory, but from the outside, it might look like it. So what I'd like to do is ask you again to get settled. I should probably preface this a little bit. Okay, as I said, we're heading into working with the deity, the deity meditation, and the deity that we're going to be working with is actually Vajrasattva. And I'm going to be talking more about the nature of Vajrasattva. As we do the next level of meditation. But you'll notice, let me just send these around for you to take a quick look at. And I want to thank everyone again, Craig, especially Hal and Justin, and for helping get these Vajrasattva images to us. And we have three Vajrasattva images here. That might be chin raising, actually. That's chin raising. But we have these two on either side of Vajrasattva. And I'll be talking more about the whole context of deity meditation in just a little bit. But the main thing that I want you to notice about Vajrasattva is that Vajrasattva is white. That white refers to the clear light, that it is a constellation of energy that brings forward and contains the clear light. And this idea of the clear light is an idea that you find throughout Buddhist practice. Sometimes you hear it referred to as the ground luminosity. And the clear light, if you've ever spent too much time with Buddhist practice, there are different references to the clear light in different contexts earlier on the path before you get to the Tantra. For instance, you have this concept of Buddha nature, and Buddha nature is Buddha nature is this aspect of ourselves that is consistently connected with the field of the clear light, which is characterized in the context of Buddha nature as compassionate, equanimous, joyful, and but which is infused with this clear light. And you also have references to the clear light when you have the teachings of the two truths, where you have the discussion of the two levels of reality or experience of reality that are possible, which is ultimate reality and relative reality. And we could talk for about a year about this concept, but the aspect of relative reality is the experience on the realm of image, where everything is related to one another, which is the way we normally experience reality. And then the experience of reality on the ultimate level is actually the experience of the clear light, which is unchanging and does not move within the forms of relative. It is there behind or within the forms of relative reality, but it is unmoving in comparison to the way in which things are changing all the time on the relative level. And the unchanging aspect is the clear light. And there are practices in Mahayana Buddhism and in Bön called Dzogchen, which is the practice of being able to perceive the clear light through any experience, or to know and have an understanding of the ultimate reality in the midst of any relative manifestation. So again, these are huge practices that I'm introducing to you in 3 minutes, but I want to give you a little bit of context for the importance of the clear light in Buddhist practice and in Buddhist understandings of the nature of reality. And ultimately, Bob is probably one of the most beautiful interpreters of the nature of the clear light and the access points to it and the way that it informs our ordinary experience. And I highly recommend listening to his podcasts. They're accessible, you can listen to them every day, where he talks about these different levels of experience of approaching the clear light. And the way in which phenomenon dissolves into the clear light ultimately. So, these are all conceptualizations that I'm mentioning here about the clear light. And what I'm going to endeavor to do in this meditation is to bring you into a visceral experience of it. So, just allowing yourself to get settled. Noticing once again, all the places where the surface under you meets the different parts of your body.
And as you do, once again, just noticing where your breath is. Noticing as you breathe in where your breath goes, and noticing as you breathe out where your breath goes. Just beginning to notice as you're breathing in and breathing out, the way in which your breath is almost like a bridge between your outer world and your inner world. And just allowing yourself with each breath to draw a bit closer into your inner world, into that place where everything that you've ever known or felt or sensed, or dreamed, or imagined, is recorded. Just following your breath into that place within you. As you breathe in, following your breath into that place within you where everything that you've ever known, or felt, or dreamed is recorded. And as you come into this place, just allowing yourself to let all of your inner senses open. Letting your inner sense of taste, touch, and smell open fully and widely. Letting your inner sense of sight and hearing open fully and widely. And especially allowing that sixth sense of just knowing to open fully and widely. And as you allow your inner senses to open, knowing that you may receive information through any of them, allow yourself to become aware of the guide that you met through the shamanic journey yesterday. Just allow yourself to become aware of the presence of the guide that you met yesterday. Noticing where you feel the guide's presence, if it's in front of you or behind you, to your left or to your right, or above or below you. And again, knowing you may receive information about the guide's presence through any of your senses, and just letting yourself connect with the guide, once again becoming aware of its nature, its personality, and the power that it carries. And just asking your guide now to bring you into the field of clear light. You don't have to know how to do this. You can just ask your guide to bring you into the field of clear light. Just follow the guide and allow your inner senses to open fully and widely as you begin to focus on what you know about the clear light. You don't have to know everything about it. Just focus on what you do know about its unchanging, compassionate clarity. Just continue focusing on what you know about the clear light and ask your guide to bring you into the field of clear light, letting all of your senses open so that you can experience the clear light through sight, through sound, through even smell, taste, through touch, or that sixth sense of just knowing. Knowing that you may experience the clear light through any or all of these senses. Knowing you don't have to focus primarily on sight in order to perceive the clear light. Compare your experience with what you already know of the clear light. And you can ask your guide for any further instruction about the nature of the clear light. (Clears throat) knowing that you may get this information through a feeling in your body, or a telepathic knowing, or even verbal instruction, or an emotional experience. And just allowing yourself to take all the time that you need and just come back to watching your breath. Breathing in and breathing out. Resting in your breath, bringing your focus to your breath. Taking all the time that you need to do that. Letting go of the experience of guide and the clear light and just returning to your breath. And just watching your breath move in and move out. Just following your breath out into the outer world, feeling the surface under you again, and when you're ready, you can stretch a bit, taking all the time that you need to come back fully into the room. Open your eyes and reflect, and perhaps write your experience. We won't have any talking during this time. I'm going to send around the spray if anyone wants it.